Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Speculation by Nisi Shawl, narrated by Joniece, Abbott-Pratt. Chapter 1. It was raining lilacs. At least that's what it looked like to Winna, sitting on her grandparents' screened-in porch. The tiny squares of dark mesh blurred things together, going in and out of focus, so silver drops of rain became the flowers they fell on, fell from, and fell all around. Winna took off her glasses to make it more like that, more mixed up and mysterious. Magic. Magic was real. Grown-ups and high school kids said there was no such thing, but Winna knew they were wrong. They just said that because they had given up. You can't give up, she muttered to herself. Mom said so all the time, even when she had to go to the hospital. Going to the hospital was not giving up. Winna stroked the spine of the book Mom had given her. Well, Mom had given her the money to buy it, digging into her purse and trusting her with a whole month's allowance before she got into a taxi cab to the hospital and shut the door and blew a kiss out of the open window as the cab pulled off down the street. Winna hadn't seen her since. 2 whole weeks. She left her glasses off and picked the book up from the patchwork quilt she had tucked around her legs so she could sit alone on the cool, flower-smelling porch. She had to put the page way up close to her face, which was supposed to be bad for you, but maybe some of the story would rub off on her. It was called The Time Garden. It was by Winna's favorite author right now, Edward Eager. He wrote about magic happening to regular, ordinary kids, just like her, or almost just like her. They were white. They always managed to find an enchanted something, a well, or a book, or a coin. Winna was tall for her age, 10, and she was constantly being told to stand up straight and act like she was proud of her height by everyone but Mom, who must have heard the same thing all her life. Winna tried to have good posture, like everyone wanted, but it was hard when she was always looking on the ground for a magic object. A ring, maybe, or a scroll of papyrus inscribed with strange runic symbols. Meanwhile, there was the book. The adventure started when Anne, Roger, Eliza, and Jack discovered an enchanted plant that let them travel in time. The magic had just whisked them away to a tropical island, and now they were trying to keep their own parents, who as children had apparently had similar adventures, from being consumed by cannibals for lunch. It was kind of funny, but scary too, because it made Winna think how if someone eats your mother as a little girl, you don't have a real good chance of being born. 40 pages passed, and the dangers of cannibals were replaced by those of fire-breathing dragons. Winna tried for the third time to brush away the spiderweb or mosquito or whatever it was that kept tickling her knee where the quilt had slipped off. She touched something soft and squiggly and damp. Gah! She cried, jumping up on the back of the armchair. But it was only her little sister, Tupelo, who stuck her wet fingers back in her mouth and started crying like the baby she was, sitting on the floor. She was always sneaking up on people. Winna sighed and rolled her eyes back so she was looking at the dirty white rafters of the porch ceiling. Can't a person get any privacy? Tupelo sniffled and took her fingers out so she could wipe her nose with the back of her pudgy brown hand.
But there wasn't nothing on TV.
Anything. There wasn't anything on TV.
There wasn't anything on TV, Tupelo amended, except Highway Patrol. And I was lonely.
Her dark eyes stared up accusingly. Winna made an effort to put herself in her sister's place, not down on the floor, but the way her guidance counselor, Miss Ross, was always trying to get her to do. Of course Tupelo was lonely, way out here in the country. Well, in Vandalia. But Vandalia practically was the country. A church, a barber's, and a post office, which was of course closed for the Memorial Day weekend. No kids they knew for miles around, unless you counted their cousin Benny, who was a year older and a little mean. So Winna would have to play with Tupelo herself. Well, what do you want to do?
I don't know.
But she looked a little better, grateful to be asked. You still got that coloring book Uncle Marv gave you?
Yeah, but I don't feel like coloring.
After a few more guesses, Winna decided that all her sister really wanted was someone to cuddle with. All right, she said, motioning with one arm. Come on up here, big girl. Let me see if I can do anything with that head. She had her comb in her back pocket, and she had to twist around to get it out, so she didn't see what happened next. She heard it. Crunch! It was an awful sound, and Winna knew exactly what it meant. Last time that sound had come from under the paws of an overly friendly German shepherd. Now, it issued forth from beneath her sister's butt. Tupelo rose right back up from the chair cushion, as if going into reverse fast enough could undo the damage. But it was hopeless. The whole weekend was ruined. When his glasses were broken. And that was that. Heavens to Betsy. Grandma didn't seem at all upset. Not compared to the way Mom was last time. Those glasses cost me $65. She had said then. Just how do you expect me to pay for more? And she had walked out the door, down the steps, and up the block to the IGA, bought some cigarettes, and started smoking again like she'd never stopped. Money was a big deal to Mom, but Grandma seemed to take what had happened a little easier, maybe because of all the cookies and pies and donuts she always made. Winna had heard it said over and over. You are what you eat. If so, Grandma was made of butter, sugar, flour, and eggs. All that soft, sweet stuff kept her from getting mad at the pieces of blue plastic lying there on the dining room table. They had already tried taping the frame back together, but the results were wobbly. When Winna put them on, the world looked all weird. Parts too far, parts too close, and leaning over like the sky was going to fall in on her head. It made her dizzy. So they took off the tape and set the pieces back on the table, where their reflections shone quietly in the dark polished wood. Heavens to Betsy, Grandma said again. Well, pretty soon your grandfather will be back from Pawpaw. He ought to have some notion what we can do. Winna nodded, but secretly she doubted that. Today was Saturday. Her eye doctor wouldn't be open till Tuesday. Even if he let her come in for an emergency, that was at home in Kalamazoo, which must be miles and miles away. So she was going to be bumbling around half blind all weekend. She would miss the fireworks. But when Grandpa Carl came in, he seemed to know exactly what to do. He left the box of groceries on the dining room table, overriding Grandma's concern for the finish.
It'll only sit there for a minute, Dot. I'll be back in two shakes of a lamb's tail.
He walked into their bedroom, and soon there were funny creaking noises coming from over their heads, shuffling, slidey sounds, too. There must be an attic, Winna thought. She walked over to the bedroom and saw that what she had always assumed was a closet door had wooden steps going up behind it, steep as a ladder. A dry, dusty smell drifted down from the top. The wood glowed golden and reddish-brown by the light of a single bulb. The string Grandpa Carl must have pulled to turn it on still danced in the air. She was about to join him when there was a loud thump and more quick, creaky noises. For some reason, Winna decided to go back to the dining room table and pretend she had been sitting there all along. Grandpa Carl didn't suspect a thing. He was smiling under his gray mustache and running his fingers through his curly hair as he walked toward them. He carried a small blue leather eyeglass case and set it on the table in front of Winna.
These belong to your great aunt Estelle, he said. Maybe they'll do the trick, at least till we can get you another pair.
They had silver frames around perfect circles of glass. Two tiny stars pierced the bridge, right where it would rest on Winna's nose. Those are a pair of real old-fashioned spectacles there, Grandma observed.
Go ahead, said Grandpa Carl. Try them.
Winna lifted the glasses from their case and saw that the earpieces curled almost all the way around, like the kind in pictures of Benjamin Franklin. They were beautiful, but different. Reluctantly, she put them on. It was like stepping into a newborn world. The dim, shadowy dining room became suddenly clear. Dark corners revealed details. Clocks and cupboards and curious carvings that ran around the walls up near the ceiling.
Wow, said Winna.
She turned and faced Grandpa Carl. Thanks. These are fabulous. She could see every little curl on his head and how it went and why it had to go that way. Grandpa Carl smiled, and she saw the lines on his face, how they fell into the places they had got used to being in for years.
Let me see you, said Grandma, on her other side.
But when Winna looked at her, she noticed tears, like dewdrops on a spider web. They flickered on Grandma's long white lashes, then flashed and disappeared.
The spitting image of my sister. Carl, doesn't she favor her? Estelle? I'd say there's a fairly strong resemblance, yes. Question is, as glasses go, do these fill the bill?
Winna nodded as hard as she could. They're even better than my old ones. Maybe it was time for a new prescription. Can I? She hesitated, then went ahead and asked. Maybe if I'm careful, you can let me keep them? A whimper came from under the table where Tupelo was hiding. She always hid under things when she did something wrong, like that was going to keep her from getting punished. But since it didn't look like anyone was going to give her a spanking right away, she had found something else to sulk about.
I want glasses, too.
Well, Grandma tried to tell Tupelo how wicked it was to want glasses when the good Lord had given her a perfectly fine pair of eyes. Winna went back out on the porch. The rain had stopped. There were still thin puddles on the dark, wet wooden steps, but the gravel driveway that curved below them had already soaked its puddles up. Winna walked down the steps and crouched at the bottom. The round pebbles looked pretty, sparkling and polished by the rain. Some she could almost see through, like watery milk. Others had tiny flecks of gold mixed with pink and black. She'd never noticed before how beautiful a regular old driveway could be. It must be the glasses, she decided. What if they're magic? She wondered out loud. What if these are magic spectacles I'm wearing? There was a sort of shimmer in the corner of her eye. It spread so quickly, she didn't have time to be afraid. It was all colors, rainbows flying off the edges of everything, as if diamonds had broken apart, as if the whole world was split into 100 images of itself, each shining brighter than the last. Then the shimmer was gone. Looking back, Winna realized that this was when the adventure began. Not with putting on Great Aunt Estelle's glasses, or her old ones getting broken, or coming to stay with Grandpa Carl and Grandma. Not earlier, and not later. Not that night, when fireworks spangled open and turned flips and somersaults and spun in circles of radiance, like stars dancing for joy. It started that afternoon. In that very moment, when she squatted, examining the cool, smooth stones, asking herself what made such ordinary things so great, wondering out loud if magic had come at last into her life. That was when she was caught up in speculation. Chapter 2. The next day was Sunday. Memorial Day was until Wednesday, according to the calendar. But Grandpa Carl said the whole week was special. At 11 o'clock in the morning, the day was already nice and hot. Ice cubes rattled pleasantly inside the big jar of lemonade Grandma handed in through the truck window. It was heavy and slippery and cold. Winna set it on the seat between her and Tupelo and moved closer to the door. The warm leather cushion was still slowly springing up from where Grandma had sat on the ride to church. You want the sandwiches up there, too? Grandma asked Grandpa Carl. She peered into the truck cab, took off her hat, smoothed its white velvet roses, and put it back on her head.
Or do you think they'll be all right in the back? Course they'll be all right, Dot. No one's going to bother them where we're going. Enjoy the sermon.
Grandpa Carl had convinced Grandma that since the entire Sunday school was working on a play about Pharaoh's daughter finding Moses in a stream, the girls would feel left out. So he was taking them on a long drive. The sandwiches and lemonade were for their picnic, and Grandma would have dinner with Aunt Pick, Benny's mom. They'd all meet back at the church for evening services. Grandpa Carl started backing out of the parking lot. Winna leaned against the door, checking to make sure it was all the way closed. Grandma saw her and waved, so Winna waved back. "Say a prayer for my mom," she shouted as they drove away. Then she felt dumb. Why had she said that? All Mom had was bronchitis, which was like a bad cold or something, and not really worth praying about. They drove off the blacktop, and the lemonade jar fell over against Winna's leg. She sat it back up straight, her fingers leaving long, dark marks on the cool, sweaty glass. "Drink me," she wrote, tracing the words in the tiny silver drops collecting on its side. "Condensation," she murmured to herself. She snuck a look at Grandpa Carl. He was sneaking a look at her.
"How's the specs?"
he asked.
"Any problems? They giving you a headache?"
"No." Winna had decided not to mention the shimmery thing that had happened in the driveway. It was only for a moment.
"How come you ain't wearing them then?"
"I don't know." She couldn't explain about the special feeling Great Aunt Estelle's spectacles gave her. She had been saving it for just the right moment in the day. At least, that's what she told herself.
"You got them with you? Put them on. I want you to see something."
Winna took the blue leather case out of her beach bag. She had packed the bag earlier on the chance Grandma could be persuaded that almost June was late enough in the calendar to go swimming. She opened the case and looked at the spectacles glittering in the changing light.
"Where you taking us, Grandpa Carl?"
Tupola never asked a question if she could whine it. Winna was trying to break her of the habit.
"I thought we'd head on up to Covey Hill."
"What's that?"
Grandpa Carl didn't answer right away. So Tupelo repeated her question a couple of more times.
"What's that? What's Covey Hill? What's that?"
"Layovers to catch meddlers,"
Grandpa Carl replied. And he wouldn't say anything else for the rest of the ride. When she was done crying about that, Tupelo tried to grab Great Aunt Estelle's spectacles. Winna quickly put them on to keep them from getting wrecked. They went on dirt roads the whole way. Most of the land around Vandalia was flat and green. Green fields full of sprouting corn, green wild meadows and woods where shadows waited to grow when the green had gotten all the sun it could take in a day. But as they drove beneath one of the stands of cool, protecting trees, the road began to rise. Then it started curving, too, so that if it hadn't been going up so much, it would have been a circle that went nowhere at all. But it went up and in and on, past turnoffs to smaller roads, and up and in again. Finally, they came to two old pillars made of stones, standing right next to the road. Grandpa Carl stopped the truck with the engine still running and got out. He knocked on one pillar as if it was someone's door, waited a minute, then came back in the truck. Winna wanted to ask what he was doing, but not after how he had ignored Tupelo. He drove past the pillars in silence. The road got worse, all muddy, and the truck rocked slowly up and down as they drove in and out of big puddles in their way. Winna couldn't see why Grandpa Carl kept going, and then she couldn't see why he had stopped.
"All right, boot noses. Here we are. Got your specs on, Winna? Good."
Now that they had stopped moving, it was obvious what Covey Hill was. It was, or had been, a cemetery. The teetering crosses and headstones seemed sad, as though nobody had looked at them in years and years. Some of them had vines growing over them, which was pretty. The vines were like the veils that hang down from ladies' hats and hide their faces. Lonely faces, hidden from the world. Grandpa Carl got out of the truck, taking Tupelo out on his side. But Winna sat by herself for a minute, listening to the crinkling noises that came from under the hood. The engine was cooling off. She saw curls of heat rise in the air, wavering like ghosts. "What if there are ghosts I could see?" she said, asking aloud. "What if there really are ghosts, and these glasses are so good, they make me see them?" There was a sudden rippling before her eyes. When it was gone, she thought at first nothing had changed. Then she noticed the lady in white walking up the hill with Tupelo and Grandpa Carl. She was very tall, and her long white dress was blowing in the wind. Only there was no wind. Winna got out of the truck, to be sure. Grass and alfalfa tickled the backs of her knees, springing up from where she had stepped. But the air was absolutely still. It was a ghost. The lady was a ghost. This was not the sort of magic Winna had expected. Dead people, scary stuff like that. The would-be good kids in E. Nesbitt books never had to deal with any ghosts. What should she do? "Grandpa Carl! Grandpa Carl!" Grandpa Carl turned around and waved. His arm went right through the lady, who stopped. Now Winna could see how she sort of wobbled and floated around. Winna started to cry, which was a silly thing to do. The ghost wasn't hurting anybody. Was she?
"Come on, boot nose," said Grandpa Carl. "There's some coals up this way. Your mama's people are all over here."
They sure are, she thought. Even though she was frightened, Winna had to laugh. Over to one side, she saw more white shapes moving, blurry because of the tears. She made up her mind not to be afraid, like some baby, like Tupelo. She took off the glasses to wipe her eyes. The ghosts were gone. She polished the lenses as quickly as she could and put them on again. A girl in white was walking away from a group of other ghosts. She was smiling. She was headed straight for Winna. It was the spectacles, obviously. It was happening just the way Winna had wondered if it might. There were ghosts, and the spectacles made her able to see them. If she didn't want to, all she had to do was keep the glasses off. But did that mean they wouldn't be there? Or that they would be there, only invisible? The girl in white was really close. She stopped and said something Winna couldn't hear. Her lips were moving, but no sound was coming out. "Well," thought Winna, "I didn't ask what it would be like to listen to ghosts." One thing she knew from reading, magic had rules. She'd better find them out. "Hi," she said to the girl. "Sorry, but I can't hear a single word you're saying." The girl bit her lip. She made the kind of face you make when you don't want people to know how bad you feel. She shrugged and started walking off, back the way she came. "Wait," Winna shouted. Grandpa Carl thought she meant him.
"I ain't going nowhere. Come on, sugar, get that boot nose up here where it belongs."
"Just a minute." Winna was already walking after the girl. The girl was sort of drifting, but Winna had to thrash her way through thistles and raspberries before she caught up with her. She tried to whisper as loud as she could.
"Wait! Hey, you! Wait up!"
At last, the ghost seemed to hear. She stood still, except for wavering a little. Her old-fashioned white dress kept on blowing in the same non-existent wind as the ladies did, and the lilac-colored ribbons tied at the top of her long black braids moved a little too, like they would be rustling if they made a noise. As Winna came closer, the girl turned around and looked back. She had a nice face, wide and round, with dark eyes like deep water and curly lashes. It was funny looking into her eyes, which were calm and steady, while the rest of her kept moving around as if she wasn't exactly there. But the eyes were waiting. Waiting for what Winna would say. "You can't give up. You shouldn't just quit that way. Winna found herself explaining to the ghost. I mean, we'll figure out how to talk, okay? If it's really important. Like semaphores. Semaphores were flag signals they used on ships before the invention of radio. Winna knew all about them from a report she did in history. Or we'll use something else. A secret code or something, all right? The ghost nodded slowly.
Winna, what's got into you? We can't be waiting here all day.
Sorry, Grandpa Carl, she shouted. Come on, she whispered to the ghost, holding out her hand. It looked like the ghost took it, but all Winna felt was a current of warmth. Like when you're swimming in a shady lake, and you come to a part where the sun shines. Chapter 3. The ghost led the way through Covey Hill. Winna could see how where they went was probably once a path. The tall grass was thinner here, and there weren't any prickers or itchy weed. The place where Tupelo and Grandpa Carl stood was next to a thick patch of plants with long, sword-like leaves. Poking up between were thin stems that held flower buds, fat and dark. The lady shimmered behind them, a worried look on her face. Mom loves these flowers, Winna said to Grandpa Carl when she got close enough. She tried to pretend she didn't see the lady, since nobody else did, except the other ghost, who went over and started talking with her silently. Grandpa Carl stooped down and pulled up some grass.
She does she? You know what kind of flowers these are, Winna?
Irises. They're her favorites. I wish they were open and I could pick some to bring her. Winna stopped. The glasses were magic, and she knew it was a bad idea to go around making casual wishes in the presence of magic. But nothing happened, as far as she could tell. No flowers opened before her very eyes, like in a science film. She decided she'd figure out the rules of the magic as soon as she got a chance to be alone.
See if you can get rid of some of these weeds, girls. The family used to come up here and clear things away every Memorial Day, but hasn't too much got done lately. Gardening is hard on an old man like me.
Tupelo sat down and started plucking at the grass blades with one hand. The other hand was in her mouth. The fingers, anyway. Winna knew it did no good to just pick at stuff. You had to get the whole plant, root and all. She sighed, and then went behind her sister, digging clumps of twisty yellow roots from the soft, cool soil. The girl ghost came back over and watched.
Your great-great-grandmother, Winona Cole, is buried here, girls,
said Grandpa Carl.
She loved irises, too.
And now she is irises, thought Winna, and a floaty thing that only I can see. She glanced nervously at Tupelo, but it didn't look like she was any closer to bursting into tears than usual.
How do you know this is great-great-great-grandmother Winona's grave? She asked. I don't see any, tombstone.
Just two grates. I guess it is kind of overgrown. Up here.
Grandpa Carl pushed aside a mass of gray-green leaves, and Winna saw the arch of granite showing through. She moved closer to examine it. Winona Gonder Cole, born 1845, died 1901. There is no sorrow in heaven. Winna did some quick arithmetic. Winona Gonder Cole had died when she was 56. That seemed pretty old. But of course, people got much older. Grandpa Carl was almost 75. Mom said they were going to have a big party for him at the family reunion late in June, and she would be completely well by then and take Winna and Tupelo. Did you know great-great-grandmother Winona, Grandpa Carl? She asked.
I wasn't much more than a child when she passed,
he replied.
But all the colored around here knew each other at that time.
What was she like?
Well, I don't believe I can say for a fact. Most of what I remember about Winona likely comes from stories I heard about her. How she got sadder and sadder her whole long life.
Story! Story! Shouted Tupelo. I want a story.
Grandpa Carl looked all around. Not like he noticed anything at all. He just looked around at nothing, and Tupelo got the idea.
Please?
She added.
Pretty please?
Okay, Bootnose. But first, let's get back to the truck. Those sandwiches are waiting on us, and I suspect there's some fish need catching down at Lawson Lake. I'll tell you about Winona on the way.
They headed down the hill. The girl ghost walking with Winna. The lady ghost waved one wavery white arm. The girl ghost waved back at her. When they reached the truck, the ghost got in the back.
What if she blows away?
Winna wondered. She went around and climbed in over the tailgate. Grandpa Carl, is this all right?
Sure, sugar.
Tupelo stuck her head out the door and squinted at her.
But Winna, you'll miss the story.
No, she won't,
said Grandpa Carl. He showed them how the rear cab window slid open so Winna could listen in. Everybody got settled. Winna put her arm around the ghost just to make sure she wouldn't get whisked off. They went slow at first, anyway. Grandpa Carl had to back out a long ways to find a turnaround. A couple of times, Winna was almost sure he saw the ghost girl. He was looking right at her. But if he had seen her, he would have said something. Instead, all he did was tell the story, which went like this.
Winona's tale. You two know about slavery, don't you? That's right. People claiming they own.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.